Come on, come on in, everybody. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope everybody speaks English, because my French is terrible. If you don't speak English, we'll speak rum, and we'll talk to you through rum. But I'd like to thank you for taking the time out of a great show to come listen to hear me talk about Worthy Park and talk about Jamaica, give you a little insight into what we do, what the island does, and where Jamaica rum is and how we drink rum in Jamaica. So I want this not to be just about Worthy Park, but about the island of Jamaica, the people, the culture, the heritage, because it's all a big part of rum for us. To start it off, yes, I am Jamaican. I'm Chinese Jamaican. I know it's an elephant in the room I always have to address. My family got to Jamaica in the early 1900s. So we're Jamaican, Chinese Jamaican, but I grew up in Canada, hence my wacky accent that's all over the board. I don't even know what my accent is anymore. But without further ado, I'd like to start talking about Worthy Park. Now, for those of you that don't know Worthy Park, we are in Jamaica. We are in central Jamaica. Has anybody been to Jamaica yet? No? Oh, perfect. So it's a fresh crowd. That means no one can argue with anything I'm saying. So, Jamaica, we're a little, small little island in the Caribbean. This is our flag. We're very proud of our flag. We were first inhabited by the Arawak Indians. They lived a relatively peaceful life until 1494 when Columbus, I don't like to say he discovered Jamaica because we were already there, but he landed in Jamaica. And we were a Spanish colony until 1655. When the British captured the island. At that time, there was about 2,500 people, Spaniards, on the island, so it was relatively easy for the British. They couldn't capture Hispaniola, they couldn't capture Cuba, but there was no one defending Jamaica from the Spanish side, so it was pretty easy for them to take over. But yeah, we are gone from fishing village to Spanish colony, to the jewel of the British Empire, to an independent nation in 1962. So we have about 3 million people on island, 2.7 million people officially. There's actually more Jamaicans living overseas than there are living in the island of Jamaica. We have a lot of immigration from the island.
Jamaica's about 4,200 square miles. To give you a reference of size, if I was to drop Jamaica on top of Paris, this is... Yeah, come on in, guys. You're on Jamaican time. It's okay. We're always late. If we were to drop the island of Jamaica on top of Paris, this is how big we would be. This is Kingston. This is where I live. Worthy Park would be right around here. And all the tourism areas are kind of on the north coast. So the island of Jamaica as well, because none of you have been there, right? But Jamaica is one of those islands. No matter where you are in the world, if I say Jamaica, you have some sort of reference to it, right? There's always something that you think about. Could be our track stars. We have some of the fastest females in the world. Shelly-Ann Price, she just had a baby 2 years ago and just won gold world championship. So big up Shelly-Ann Price. We have some of the fastest men in the world. Of course, everybody knows Usain Bolt. For all the music fans here, the Scatolites, ska music originated in Jamaica. Up to, you know, Chronix, who is one of the leaders of the reggae music now. And Coffee, she's like 18 years old. It's a girl who's singing on the track right now. It could be Cool Runnings. I'm sure most of you have seen that movie. Could be our white sand beaches. We've got some great beaches on island. This is actually my favorite beach right now, just outside of Ocharias. But we have dope-ass surfers in Jamaica, too. If anybody's into surfing, South Coast, we got great surfing beaches. Blue Mountain Coffee, well-regarded, well-known rum in the world. Jamaican Jerk. I don't mean the people. I mean the chicken and the pork. Could be our agricultural scene. Michael was the first to laugh. He knows what I'm talking about. Funny story, that's actually how he's a vendor at a party, and that's how he walks around, and that's how you can buy ganja at parties in Jamaica. So you would ask for like a $50 bag, and he would just break off a piece and give you. But I can talk to you all day about Jamaica, but we're ultimately here to talk about rum. And before I waste any more of your time, let's get started with that. So the first number one on your sampling is our Worthy Park Single Estate Reserve. Our rum bar line was our first line that we launched internationally, but we knew with our history and heritage of Worthy Park, we wanted to launch a rum. We wanted to launch a family of rums under the Worthy Park name. So the first one we launched a couple years back is a blend of our rums between 6 and 10 years old. We did all our aging in American white oak ex-bourbon casks, and we bottled it at 45%. Now, with all Worthy Park rums, one thing you have to understand is we don't add any sugar to our rums. So any sweetness that you get in there is through our distillation and through our aging. So there's no extra flavors, extra sweetening, extra additives in there. It's just real Jamaican rum. Now, this is one we talk a lot about. You'll hear me talk about pot still style, which is, for us, when we talk about pot still, it's a traditional way of making rum in Jamaica, but it also gives us those complex, deep flavors that are funkiness that people talk about when they're referring to Jamaican rum. I'm going to go into the production methods a little more, but I didn't want you guys to sit there with the glasses in front of you before you try it. So Worthy Park Estate, you can look at us as three different operations. So we're a sugar farm, we're a sugar factory, and ultimately we're a distillery. Now, why I say we're Jamaica's only single estate producer, because we're the only distiller in Jamaica that uses 100% of our own molasses for rum production. Now, Jamaica as a whole is a net importer of molasses, but based on our production levels at Worthy Park, we can supply our distillery with enough molasses. Just go through a couple of dates for you to keep in mind. So Worthy Park was founded in 1670. So 15 years after the British captured Jamaica, Lieutenant Francis Price patented 840 acres in central Jamaica. And now we've grown from 840 acres to almost 10,000 acres of land. And that was, started in 1670. In 1720 was our first record of commercial sugar production. We've done sugar every year since 1720. So nearly 350 years straight, we've been a commercial sugar producer on the island. Our first record of rum production is 1741. That predates any existing distillery on the island. So any other Jamaican rums that are out there, any other distilleries, we have the oldest record of rum production out of the rest of them. 1918, Gordon, who's my boss, his family, his great-grandfather bought Worthy Park, and he's owned it ever since. So it's been in his family 101 years. We're also proud to say we're family-owned and operated, and 100% Jamaican-owned and operated as well. In 1962, we actually stopped distillation at Worthy Park. At the time, we were making rum as a commodity, just like our sugar. We would make it in bulk. We would sell it to blenders or bottlers overseas, but we didn't have any brands. Now, in 1962, there was an overproduction of Jamaican rum on the island, and the spirits pool, which we're all a part of, recommended that some of the producers stop making rum. So because we didn't have a brand, we were just selling in bulk, it was very easy for us to transition to selling our molasses to the open market. So we came out of our rum production, and in 2004, we restarted. So we made the decision to build a brand new distillery, and we started rum officially again in 2005. So after a 40-plus year hiatus, we were back in the rum business. Now, our sugarcane fields, out of our 10,000 acres of land, we have 4,000 acres just devoted to sugarcane. Our crop season is from January to July, so 6 months of the year is when we harvest sugarcane, and we have over 20 varieties of cane. Now, we do, at Worthy Park, we hand cut 80% of our fields. The real reason we do that is because where we're based is in the mountains. We're 1,200 feet above sea level, so our topography is very hilly. So we actually have to cut by hand. The combine cane harvesters, which we have, would not, they would tip over. So 80% cut by hand, 20% by machine. And while the machine cut is faster, the hand cutting actually gives us a better cut of cane. So we're more efficient in that regard. Now, the sugar cane fields at Worthy Park, I said we have over 20 varieties. We cut each plot of field once per year. So you can see on the left, this one was cut probably earlier on in the year. This one is probably about, probably 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks of growth. And after we cut the fields, the rest of the year we're farming them. We're trying to grow as best quality and as much cane as possible. So this is an example of us cutting by hand. So when you cut by hand, you make two cuts on the cane. So you make one cut on the bottom, right above the root, and then you make one cut on the top to cut the remaining grass off of it. Now you can see our cane is kind of dark, right? It looks almost black. It's because we clear our fields the night before. We do a controlled burn of our cane fields. So what that does is it cuts away all the dead grass that's on the cane, and it makes it easier for the cane cutters to get through the fields. Otherwise, they would have to shave each stalk of cane for all the dead grass off. Now, also why this is more efficient than the machine is because if you just take a look around the room, we're all different heights. It's the same thing for the cane. It grows at different speeds. So the machine, we set it at one height. And depending on the height, we're either cutting too much off of some stalks or too little off of some. So cutting by hand gives you the more efficient method of cane cutting. And these are just some of our cane cutters. His name's Boxer, go figure. After the cane field is cut, we pile our cane into one of our cane carts and we take it to the sugar factory for processing. The cane cutters, they cut one row of fields for two people. So two people work in one row. And they get paid based on the weight of the cane that they cut. And then we also, of course, cut by combine cane harvester. We don't trouble your corn. We don't trouble your pimento. So our fields last on average about 7 years before we have to replant them. So some fields, we'll replant them after 4 or 5 years. Some will go up 9 or 10. But at Worthy Park, we actually have some cane fields that haven't been replanted in 20 years. It's a testament to our farmers. Our farm manager is very, very good at what he does. burn down the cane fields. And, you know, Worthy Park is like a little village. Where we're located, there's not really much around us. The closest town has 3,000 people. At Worthy Park during cane season, we have 850 employees on staff, and everybody lives at Worthy Park. So it is like a little village. And, you know, for all you music buffs that are listening, this song is from the 60s when they were doing a lot of drug raids in Jamaica, and they burned down the ganja fields. And this song is basically saying, you know, if you keep burning down our ganja fields, we're going to burn down your cane fields. Because that was, you know, how the government makes money in Jamaica. So sugar processing, for any of you that have seen a sugar factory, it is pretty intense what goes through making sugar. So we are the most efficient sugar factory in Jamaica. It takes us about nine tons of cane to make a ton of sugar. For reference, the closest producer to us, it takes about 13 and almost 14 tons of cane to make a ton of sugar. So we're pretty efficient. When the cane's received, it gets a sample taken from the core sampler, and we measure the cane for cane juice and fiber content, because that's how the farmers get paid. So they get paid based on the quality of their cane. We receive the cane, and we have these 60-ton cranes that bring it over to the plant for processing. The first step is washing. So we wash the cane, make sure it's clean, any residual mud is gone. And then we send it through our mill. We have 5 of these mills that crushes and extracts the juice, which is all here on the left-hand side. And then after the juice is extracted, you're left with bagasse. The bagasse for us, we use it, again, we burn it to create steam, which is used in the sugar making process. And this is one of the boilers where we burn the bagasse through. Now the cane juice is pretty muddy when it comes out. So we actually call it muddy water. And the first step is clarification. So we add flocculant, or we add lime to it. And what the lime does is it separates the muddy water from the clear cane juice. And the muddy water gets sent to a rotary vacuum filter. And that vacuum filter then extracts the juice from the mud. And that mud gets sent back to the cane fields to be used as fertilizer. And so it goes from this color for the muddy water through the vacuum filter, and it comes out as the clarified juice there. That clarified juice works through a series of 5 evaporators, and after that you're left with a cane syrup. And that cane syrup then goes to one of our 5 vacuum boilers, and the vacuum boilers are where the cane sugar is grown, actually. And these are the evaporators on the right here, and our vacuum pans on the left-hand side there. Now, after it goes through the vacuum pans, you're left with what's called massaquite. And the massaquite is a mixture of molasses and sugar. That's what it looks like there. It goes through a rotary vacuum filter, and you're left with the molasses, obviously, which goes to the distillery, and brown Jamaican cane sugar. So we don't make white sugar in Jamaica. That's what we make. And out of the process, you can see we start with the massaquite. You get A sugar and A molasses. A sugar is commercial sugar. The A molasses we send back to the production to try to extract more of the sugar from it. Then it goes through that process, and you get B sugar and B molasses again. B sugar is sold commercially, and the B molasses is sent back to the vacuum pans to grow more sugar. We're always trying to extract and be as efficient as possible. And then the C sugar is melted down and used back in production. And the C molasses is blackstrap or final molasses. And that is what gets sent to the distillery for rum distillation. That's just an overview of our sugar factory and Worthy Park. And let's move on to the second rum, shall we? It's our Worthy Park 2006. It's our 12-year-old. Once we started distilling again in 2005, we started aging. So we have up to 14-year-old rum now at Worthy Park. But last year was the first time we ever launched a vintage rum from Worthy Park. We chose 2006 because it was just really tasty when we tried it. And 12 years just sounded really good. And so we launched that. We did a limited bottling for the U.S. and a limited bottling for the EU. And with this rum, it's all ex-bourbon. It's bottled at cask strength. So we lost about 9% ABV, and it's bottled at 56%. And as the last point to that, as coming directly from the distillery, that's probably the oldest Jamaican pot still rum that's on the market right now. So sugar, you know, cane is not endemic to Jamaica. It came from Haiti in about 1509. The Spaniards didn't really, they made sugar for local consumption, but it wasn't until the British took the island that sugar was made on a commercial level for Jamaica. We quickly overtook Barbados and became the largest producer of sugar for the British colonies. And we were essentially the cash cow for the Queen for quite a long time. Now, the decline of sugar is obviously directly related to the abolishment of slavery in the Caribbean. Jamaica was never efficient as a sugar producer. So we were good and we produced a lot because of our size, but Barbados and some of the Leeward Islands are actually more efficient producers than us. Why Jamaica made a lot of money was, you know, because of slavery. And, you know, it's not something that everyone's comfortable talking about, but it's also not something you can talk about the islands without talking about either, because it's really more of an injustice not to reference it and understand where the history of rum and where it came from. So in 1834, slavery was abolished officially, but they had a period of what was called apprenticeship, where the slaves were technically free, but they had to work on the plantations that they were previously working for, but they had a reduced work schedule, and they could farm their own crops as well. So it didn't really work, and in 1838, Jamaica announced slavery was officially abolished, apprenticeship was abolished, but that is when you also see the levels of sugar production declining. And as you can see, at the turn of the 1900s, we had almost 150 sugar factories in Jamaica. And why that's related to rum is because all of these sugar factories were making rum. So in 1900, we had about 148 rum producers on island. By the late 1990s, we had 8. And in terms of sugar factories, for next year, we're only going to have 3 operating sugar factories in Jamaica, Worthy Park being one of them, Appleton being the other, and there's a company called Frome, which is the other producer. So why this relates to rum is we're all molasses-based producers. So Jamaica is an importer of molasses, a net importer of molasses. So down the road, 5-10 years, you know, we're really not sure where the supply of molasses is going to come for some of the bigger producers in Jamaica. Thankfully for Worthy Park, we're still making our own sugar, so we're kind of sheltered for at least the short term. This is a layout of modern Jamaica sugar, which also relates to the distilleries. So you can see on the right, Golden Grove, they're done. They finished sugar production this year. Money Musk on the South Coast, this was their last year for sugar, so they're done as of next year. Appleton will continue to make sugar. Worthy Park will. Long Pond Sugar Factory, they haven't been in operation since about 2015-16. And Frome Sugar Factory is still in operation. Now, Jamaica, Worthy Park we're rated to be only produce 13,000 tons of sugar a year, but we continually overproduce. We do about 24,000 tons of sugar. We've been the largest Jamaican sugar producer for the last 3 years. As you can see, some of the other factories are rated to a hell of a lot more sugar than us, but because of production inefficiencies, they drastically underproduce to their capacity. And this is just to show you, molasses, Worthy Park, we made about 8,000 tons of sugar this year, of molasses. Jamaica then imported about 50,000 tons of molasses. So it's a literal shit ton of molasses that we're bringing onto the island. So let's talk a little bit about rum drinking in Jamaica. So a lot of people, when they talk to me about coming to Jamaica, you know, the first thing is, man, we want to find some great bars and get some daiquiris and get some Mai Tais and get all these really awesome cocktails that they're used to drinking in Europe or North America. But we don't drink like that in Jamaica. Like there, you get a daiquiri in Jamaica, it's usually from a hotel bar, and it's usually frozen, and it's usually sweet as shit, and it usually doesn't taste good. Same thing with pina coladas. This is how we drink rum in Jamaica. These are all rum bars. So as you can see, advertising and marketing in Jamaica is very different than overseas. Branding bars is very important. That's how we do most of our advertising. This one in the middle is called Glitter Girls Sports Bar and Restaurant. The one over here is called One of a Kind, and they spell kine, for all you English majors, K-Y-N-E, which I doubt anybody has ever seen. This is the Vibes House. This is Sonia's Seafood Depot and Haberdashery, so you can get rum, you can get fish, you can get toilet paper, you can get deodorant, you can get everything from these little bars. Andrea here on the bottom right, she owns a bar called Drum Stop Chill Spot. She used to have a bar called Drum with a D, D-R-U-M, how you're supposed to spell it. But when the owner took it from her, she opened up her own bar, wanted to call it Drum as well, so she spelt it with a J. So it's J-R-U-M, Spot Chill Spot. So this is rum drinking in Jamaica. You go to the bar, you order, we call it a flask or a Q, which is a little 200 ml bottle, and you order your chaser. So we drink Ting, which is a grapefruit soda a lot. So we go to the bar and say, give me a Q of rum and a Ting, and they would bring you a nice bucket. If it's us three at the bar, they give us three glasses, our rum and our Ting, and we make our own drinks. And this is how we drink rum in Jamaica. These rum bars, we have about 20,000 rum bars in Jamaica. So you can play dominoes, you can gossip, you can hear music and eat food. That's kind of the trifecta of Jamaican rum drinking. You have to have rum, you have to have music, and you have to have food. If it's a wedding, if it's a funeral, if it's a christening, if it's a birthday, if it's a Wednesday, that's how we drink rum in Jamaica. And bring us to our distillery. This is 4 acres of land that was previously sugar field. So when we built the distillery in 2004, we converted all that to distillery buildings. It's a total of 4 acres of land. We talk a lot about yeast in Jamaica, rum production. We use three types of yeast. We use a commercial dry activated yeast for consistency. We use an isolated proprietary yeast from our cane fields. And then we also use a wild yeast. So a lot of Jamaican rum, we talk about Dunder and we talk about muck pits. We don't do that at Worthy Park. We leave that to our partners in Trelawney. That's their expertise. But what we do is we create our wild yeast using 20,000 liter vats. We put in molasses, cane juice, and cane stalks. And the yeast that develops from there after 90 days is what we use for fermentation of our high ester rum. So fermentation tanks, we have 6 80,000 liter fermentation tanks. 4 of them are for our light rum production, and 2 of them are for our high ester rum production. Now our light rum production is 30 hours, and it's closed fermentation and temperature controlled. Our high ester rum production goes up to 3 weeks. So it's 2 to 3 weeks, there's no temperature control, and it is closed fermentation as well. Our distillation is all done on this Forsyth double retort pot still. So this is 18,000 liters, so it's relatively big. This is on the second level. You take the stairs up. If I was to stand up in front of it, my head would be about here, just to give you an idea of the size. Each batch is about 4 to 5 hours for us, and we do, for a day, we could do max about 8,000 or so liters of absolute alcohol. And it's fully automated. We have the only fully automated double retort pot still in Jamaica. The wash starts at 9% and is heated. We have an external steam calandra, and it heats up the wash. It evaporates and condenses into our low wine retort, where it's about 30% ABV. The same process happens again, except this wash is heated by the vapors coming off the first pot. After condensation and evaporation, you're looking at about 60% ABV. And then after that, the same process again. Our rum cut is about 85 to 87% alcohol by volume. And that process is about 4 to 5 hours. Now, for those of you that know a lot about pot stills, you're probably looking at this thing and saying, what the hell is that? So that is, after we installed our pot still, we tried to install a rectifier to get a lighter cut of rum. And the damn thing doesn't work. So we spent 20,000 euros on a ornament for our pot still. So we're actually in the process of retrofitting it now, trying to get it working. But otherwise, it's just open and it's just for show. All right, we talk a lot about pot still versus column still production for us as Jamaican rum producers. This method of production is a traditional way of making rum in Jamaica. This dates back to the early 1800s. As far as we can trace back, we've always used pot, double retort pot stills in Jamaica. Every producer on island has at least one of these. Some have up to five. And the modern day column still didn't arrive into Jamaica until about the 1960s. Which is relatively late. Jamaica, we're stubborn. We didn't feel like we needed to install a column. You know, Cuba, Puerto Rico, Dominican, a lot of the Latin countries went this route, but we held out basically until some of the producers in Ireland were making vodka for Smirnoff. And that's when you started seeing column stills come in, and that's when you started seeing you know, light column still rum being aged. Now, there's no, you know, you drink what you like to drink. You know, I'm not here to tell you that pot still is better than column still or vice versa, but it's just for you to, for us to try to explain what some of the differences are and for you to make, you know, to you, for you to understand why when you drink our white rum, it's much different than a white rum, say, out of Puerto Rico. You know, no names, no brands, but you know where I'm going. So we're looking at, you know, the pot still is a very artisanal way of producing rum versus a very industrial way of making spirits. So on the modern day multi-column, you can make vodka, you can make ethanol, you can make very neutral spirit. All we can make off our pot still is rum. It takes us, say, about 2 hours to produce 400 liters of rum. But from these multi-column stills, you're looking at 400 liters in maybe 10 minutes or so. So that is also why a lot of rum coming off multi-column stills is inherently cheaper, because it is a lot, takes a lot less time to make the same amount of rum. And double retort pot still dates back centuries. Column still is a very modern invention. Now, our aging warehouse, we have about 10,000 barrels total aging at Worthy Park. Majority of our barrels are from Brown-Forman in the States, or once-used ex-bourbon barrels. About 2 years ago, we started bringing in some ex-wine casks. So we now have port casks aging at Worthy Park, as well as Madeira casks. This year, we brought in some cognac and Calvados. So we're experimenting with much different types of aging at Worthy Park, just trying to give us you know, give us some versatility in rum that's coming out of Jamaica. And our angel share, or as we call it in Jamaica, Duffy share, is about 4 to 6%. Now, our evaporation is relatively low, because we're so high, 1,200 feet above sea level. So it does get very hot and humid during the day. But at night, it does get very cold at Worthy Park. Cold for Jamaica standards, where it can be about maybe 18 degrees Celsius, 20 degrees Celsius. But, you know, we're freezing at that point. Our bottling and blending and aging is all done at Worthy Park. Again, why I refer a lot to being a single estate producer. We have two lines. We have a manual line, does about 500 standard cases a day. And our more automated line does about 1,000 cases a day. We can do everything from 200 ml flasks up until 1.75 liter bottles. Now, as I said, you know, I touched a little bit on this before. The Jamaican rum history, you know, we've always been a big sugar producer, which in turn made us a big rum producer. A lot of marks you'll see today, like our partners from Italy, you know, Velier is releasing a lot of different rums, Wedderburn, Vale Royale, which all those names are actually relate back to sugar plantations and distilleries. So those are all very historic rum producers in Jamaica, which are no longer around. Now, as I was telling you, in 1962, when we stopped distillation, we were one of nine other distilleries that stopped rum production. in Jamaica. And now we're left with four rum producers making rum at 6 distilleries in Jamaica. So we've dropped quite a long way in production of rum. All right, the last sample I have for you is number 3. And that is a release that we've literally launched on Saturday here. It's with Les Maisons de Whiskey. It's a single cask bottling. We took our WPE, which is our highest ester rum that we make, and in 2017, we started aging it for the first time. So that is the first time we ever aged our WPE mark, and after 2 years in ex-bourbon, you're left with about 67% ABV and a whole lot of esters. Just for reference sake, for anybody that does, you know, focus on ester counts and ester levels, there's about 600 parts per million in that rum versus our light rum, like the Worthy Park Single Estate and the 12-year-old that you had. Those base rums would have about 120 parts. So this is a lot higher. I see someone adding water to it. Please don't be afraid to add a little water to it. It'll open it up and it'll take away, give you a lot different experience on it. How are we doing for time? All right, cool. We got 10 more minutes. Now, the Jamaican rum landscape. Rum is still the biggest. Beer is the biggest by case category in Jamaica. But when you break it down to servings, rum by far is the highest consumption alcohol in Jamaica. Remember I told you we have 2.7 million people in Jamaica? Rum as a category, we do about 850,000 9-liter cases a year. So we drink a lot of rum. Now, of that 850,000 9-liter cases, 600,000 are the unaged white overproof rum. Now, if you stop by our booth, we have our rum bar overproof, which is an example of that. By far, the industry leader is Ray & Nephew. They've been the oldest brand. They've been established for years. Theirs is a blend of Pot and Column, but you know, overproof rum for us is culturally, it's a way of life. So we don't just drink it. We use it as medicine. If you're sick, if you have a fever, put some on your forehead. If you're congested, you can smell it and should clear your sinuses a little bit. Does anybody have a small child in here? Children? Anybody have children? My son is 2 and he's teething. So if it's really bad, I'll put a little bit on my finger and rub it on his gums. And he sleeps well. I guess it works. Now, the four companies in Jamaica, Campari owns Ray & Nephew, which is Appleton Estate Products and J. Ray & Nephew. They're arguably the biggest Jamaican rum. They were also one of the first Jamaican rum brands. So they had the foresight in, you know, in the 1800s to create their own branded products, which is why they're, you know, reflective and why they're the biggest producer now. I mean, the rum is good too, but they do blends mostly of Pot and Column that's coming out of there. You also have National Rums of Jamaica. National Rums of Jamaica is really interesting because it's a conglomerate. It's owned 33% by the Jamaican government. It's owned 33% by DDL, which is Demerara Distillers Limited. And it's owned 33% by Maison Ferrand, which everybody knows here, producer of plantation rums. Now, they own 2 distilleries, Money Musk or Clarendon Distillery and Long Pond Distillery. Long Pond has been producing off and on. It's been closed for a few years. They reopened. Then they had their fire. Money Musk Distillery is really interesting. They have a combination of pot and multi-column stills there. Now, because majority of their production is for Diageo internationally, Diageo actually owns a percentage of Money Musk Distillery. So they don't own a part of National Rums of Jamaica, but they own a portion of Clarendon Distillery, which just makes it really confusing. Now, just to confuse everybody even more, I talked about Long Pond Sugar Factory. Long Pond Sugar Factory is not owned by the Long Pond Distillery. It's completely separate. Long Pond Sugar Factory is owned by Everglades Farms, which is Hampden Estate. So just to confuse everybody a little bit more, the last producer on island is Hampden Estate. Andrew Hussey is the owner. He's here actually as well. He's a friend of ours. They're the only other complete Jamaican-owned producer coming out of the island. They had their sugar factory, but they've stopped now. So they're unfortunately using some of the molasses that's pooled. But some of their brands are Hamden Estate, which you can get at the Velier stands, and Rumfire, which you may know as Rumfire Velvet here in the EU, but those are their brands. And they're the ones that are really known for the muck pits and the dunder pits in Jamaica. So if you come down, if any of you come down to Jamaica, you come visit us and Worthy Park, and we make our rum in a very controlled, consistent way because we're a newer distillery, but still with the old-fashioned pot still. And then you contrast with Hamden, who, man, their distillery is amazing. It's like it's stuck in time, but it's really cool to see the contrast of distilleries. But we're all making Jamaican rum, and we're all making it our own unique way. Worthy Park, that's us, in case you didn't remember. The last kind of point I want to touch about from Jamaica is we hear a lot overseas that rum is a category that has no rules, and it's like the Wild West, and you can kind of do whatever you want in rum, which is not true. Jamaica, we have rules. We have our excise. We have our Excise Act, which stipulates that nothing can be added to rum except for caramel for color or water for dilution. The CARICOM rum standard, which is all some of the English-speaking islands follow, and they stipulate everything from how you age, what can be added to rums, flavored rums and spice rums, etc. And then more importantly, we have our Jamaica Rum GI, which was registered in 2016. And that is basically covering what can be called Jamaica rum. So all of our distilleries joined together, and we came up with this almost like a checklist to say that if you hit all these points, you can officially call your rum Jamaica rum. Now, it's not to say that you can produce it outside of that, because you can. So we can make a rum in Jamaica that's not aged in oak, that has sugar in it or spices in it. We can do whatever we want, but we just can't call it Jamaica rum. And that's what we're trying to protect. We're trying to protect, and from the consumer's perspective, when you pick up a bottle of Jamaican rum, that you know where it's from. And again, it's not to say you're going to like it more than something else, but it's just so you know that this is what you're comparing it against. So I'm just going to cut through these because there's a lot. In Jamaica, we have a saying, it's called the Full Hundred, which is this song here.
Yeah, you know.
And I just want you to remember at Worthy Park, we're the Full Hundred, because we're Jamaica's only single estate producer. We're 100% hot still distillation, 100% authentic Jamaican rum. We're 100% Jamaican owned and operated, and we're producers of 100% real rum from Jamaica. So please, keep that in mind. Any questions for me at all? No? No questions? Did everyone understand what I was saying? Yeah? Robert?
About cane juice and if you have any cane juice involved in your rum making, you mentioned it in your highest yeast development. Do you use cane juice anywhere else in your rum making?
So right now, first and foremost, we're a sugar factory. Majority of our revenues are from sugar, so we're trying to use all of our cane juice for sugar production. Now, that being said, we may or may not have experimented a couple months ago with making rum from cane juice. So we did start some cane juice distillation this year. Yeah. Any other questions from everybody? Can I get a show of hands? Who liked the single estate reserve, the first one, the best? No? The first rum that you tried. Who liked that one the best? No? Oh, we got one. Two. Who liked the second one, though, 2006? Hands down. And who liked the Hiester rum the best? Of course, the fucking rum geeks in the front like that one the best. Thank you guys for time. I think that's about it for me. Follow us on our rum journey. You can add me on Instagram. Add us on Facebook. Please, if anybody's ever coming to Jamaica, hit me up. Happy to arrange a tour for you. If I can't do it myself, I'll get it set up for you. But thank you so much for coming. Yeah, appreciate it. Success don't come overnight. No matter no substance over I. Sit down on the post and the street all night.
Why like said them they a studio advice? Coming up about them up.